Hello, I am Pierre Bernstein. With my colleagues Jacques Nudem and Yiteng Xing, we work on superconductors and neodymium iron-boron magnets at Normandy University in France. Today, I speak of maglev transportation. Since the 19th century, trains have been supported with wheels. Since a few decades, other techniques have been proposed. The common concept of these techniques is to support the train with magnetic forces. In this talk, I present the three main techniques that have been developed, emphasizing the superconducting magnetic levitation. Electromagnetic levitation is a concept investigated firstly in Germany, but mainly developed in China. So train levitation results from the magnetic interaction between electromagnets connected to the train and ferromagnetic rails. The current in the electromagnet is controlled by magnetic sensors. The guidance is achieved by the interaction of the rails with other electromagnets. This slide shows the location of the electromagnet and a detailed picture of the support system. An EML train has been working between the Shanghai airport and city since 2004. Its commercial speed is above 400 km per hour. However, conventional trains can't run on EML tracks and vice versa. The special drawback of the system is the heavy and slow switches shown in the picture. The main effort for developing EML lines is done in China, where several lines are working in the most populated regions of the country. This slide shows an EML prototype that reached 600 km per hour. We present now electrodynamic levitation. The use of EDL is planned for various hyperloop projects, but we'll focus on the Shuo Shinkansen, that is the only project whose construction works are in progress. Much of the information given in this part is extracted from the talk given by Hiroyuki Osaki in 2017. This slide shows the levitation and propulsion systems of the train. The train carries superconducting coils generating a 5 Tesla field. When the train is running at a large enough velocity, this field induces currents in coils shaped as a number 8 located in the lateral walls, whose interaction with the coils in the train generates the levitation and the guidance forces. For guidance purposes, opposite coils are connected. Propulsion is obtained with a linear motor whose stator coils are located in the walls. In the lower part of this figure, we see a superconducting coil in its cryostat with the cryocolor above. In the lower part of this figure, we see a superconducting coil in its cryostat with the cryocolor above. This slide shows the bogey of the train. We see the coils, the cryocoolers, and the wheels which support the train at low velocity. Here we see the principle of the cooling system and some specification of the coils. Work is in progress to replace the low critical temperature niobium titanium coils by coils made with high critical temperature coated conductors that can be cooled with liquid nitrogen. With respect to electromagnetic levitation, electrodynamic levitation presents the advantage of auto-stabilization. However, the track's construction is expensive, the trains roll on their wheels below 150 km per hour, and electrodynamic levitations suffer the same other drawbacks as the electromagnetic levitation systems. This slide shows the line under construction between Tokyo, Nagoya, and Osaka. Unfortunately, the construction is stalled for environmental reasons. We now detail the superconducting magnetic levitation principles. In this video, you see the operator cooling down a superconductor above the central pole piece of a magnetic rail section. When the superconductor is below its critical temperature, it levitates above the pole piece and the levitation is stable. The first SML demonstration was achieved at the Jiaotong University in China in 2002. The first vehicle prototype has been running on a demonstration track at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro. The levitating system consists of superconductors and cryostats and rails included magnets in the so-called ALBA configuration. Here we see the levitating system. The ALBA rail includes nonidium iron boron magnets and magnetic steel pieces to optimize the field and field gradient. The cryostat, made by the German company ATZ, contains liquid nitrogen and bulk rare earth barium copper superconductors. The slide shows the arrangement of the superconductors in the cryostat. In this slide, we see a prototype of SML vehicle built in China. It could run at 620 km per hour and carries the same cryostats as the Brazilian vehicle. The main drawbacks of SML systems are the cost of the tracks and the unpredictable availability of the magnets. The main advantages are planar tracks and the possibility to build static switches, as shown by this model built in our lab. The force of interaction between the magnet and the superconductor has two components, the levitation force and the guidance force. I say a few words on the measurements of these forces and their calculation. In the lab, for commodity, we generally measure the forces applied to the magnet. For measuring the levitation force, the superconductor is firstly cooled down at distance ZCP from the magnet. Then, the distance between the magnet and the superconductor is reduced down to Z min, where the motion of the magnet is reversed. Finally, the magnet-superconductor distance increases up to ZCP or above. The levitation force is recorded at each step of the measurements. For the guidance force measurements, the superconductor is cooled down at distance ZCP from the magnet. After temperature stabilization, the superconductor magnet distance is reduced to Z. Then, the magnet is moved parallel to the superconductor surface to Y1, where the direction of motion is reversed, and distance Y decreases to Y2. Before increasing to Y equal to zero. The guidance force is recorded at each step of the measurements. When a superconductor is cooled down in the field of a magnet above the critical temperature, the field goes through the superconductor. Below the critical temperature, the magnetic flux is canalized along flux tubes called vortices. If the separation between the superconductor and the magnet changes, so does the vortex distribution. As a consequence, shielding currents flow in the superconductor, generating a magnetic moment. The interaction of these currents with the applied field is responsible for the levitation and the guidance forces. If there is a lateral motion of the magnet with respect to the superconductor, the vortex distribution, the shielding currents, and the associated magnetic moment changes. The levitation and guidance forces can be calculated by numerical simulation. One generally combines the finite element method and the Maxwell's equations. Superconductivity is accounted for by the so-called power law. The calculation results in the determination of the current density everywhere in the superconductor, and as a result of the force of interaction between the superconductor and the magnet. The levitation and guidance forces can also be calculated with analytical models. The magnetic moment due to the shielding currents flowing in the superconductor can be written with an expression proposed by Helmut Brandt for a cylindrical superconductor. We'll use the Brandt expression, replacing thickness H by that of the layer carrying the superconducting currents, and field B by field delta B defined in this slide. The force of interaction between the magnet and the superconductor can be written as the force applied to magnetic moment in an inhomogeneous magnetic field, the levitation and guidance forces being respectively the vertical and the lateral component of this force. They are calculated with the mean value on thickness T of the gradient of the vertical component of field delta B. This slide shows levitation force cycles measured on the MgB2 sample cooled down in the field of an iridium magnet at two different temperatures and two different cooling distances. At each temperature, the force cycles measured at the different cooling distances can be reproduced, introducing the same critical current density and T values in the calculations. Here we see the guidance force applied to an MgB2 superconductor. The slope of the guidance force is negative. This shows that levitation is stable. The measurements are correctly reproduced by the calculation shown as the blue line. Here, the slope of the guidance force is positive near the origin, and levitation is unstable. Instability is also shown by the calculation, see the blue line. This slide shows the mean value of the applied field in the superconductor as a function of its lateral distance to the magnet for various z values. The model permits to determine stable and unstable regions. Conclusions. Maglev transportation is already a reality, at least in Asia. With respect to electromagnetic levitation and electrodynamic levitation, superconducting magnetic levitation presents the advantages of planar tracks and possible static switches. Improvements are required for SML to benefit from these advantages. Concerning the materials, it's mainly improving the availability and lowering the cost of neodymium iron boron magnets, or developing new magnets with high coercivity and remanent magnetization, containing materials cheaper and more available.